All right.
Yes. I love y'all. Where in the world is Ialo de Yeye Fini e Fumbola de today? I am doing what I do, sharing with you some of the things that I do, what I have, that I'm making. And so today, I have not said anything because I've been going through a lot of trying to figure out exactly what to say. I know my responsibility as a person, a faith-based leader, that I would have something to say about what's going on, because I usually have something to say about everything that's going on. So I thought that this is my opportunity, my chance, my opportunity to say it. And with me, you know, today, for those of you who this is your first time, I'm Ialode Yeyefimi Efumbolade, priestess of Ibatala, president and director of the IIASK and Yeyefimi.com. And today I have the pleasure of introducing Akanke Adefumi, a well-known woman empowerment leader globally, that you know her as Claim Your Shiro. She has helped me to claim my Shiro. And so for that, I'll have her on today because we've been talking, and as this opportunity presents itself, you will see why is it that we've been talking. So Akanke, thank you so much for, you know, encouraging me and putting me to the point where we are now. So say who you are and why are you here with Yeye Fini? Where in the world is Yalo de Yeye Fini?
Thank you. Yes. I am so honored to be here with you on Where in the World, Yeye Fini. Like Yeye Fini said, I'm Akanke Adefumi, and I help female entrepreneurs be the leader they want to be so that they can grow their business with clarity, consistency, and confidence without overwhelm. And like Yeye said, like my mom said, I keep Yeye means mom, so I'll be calling her Yeye, just so you know, or mother.
Why are you calling me mother?
Because you my mama. Just like Yeye said, there's a lot that's been happening in the world, and I've been talking with my followers about it, but this is an opportunity for us to expand our conversation, deeper into a conversation about what's happening right now in the world and how we can contribute to making an even bigger difference as people of color. And also, of course, we're speaking to our white allies as well today. So it's good to be here. And I know you have a lot to say, Yeye. I have some things to say, but you know what? Go ahead, Yeye. This is your show.
Okay. Well, for me, you know, usually I'm just talking. Where in the world is Yeye Fini? I always just give a little bit of something, then I'm gone. But today I have to bring notes because I want to stay focused, because this is a very powerful and important time. And some for you know that throughout this COVID-19, I've been coining, I don't know if I coined it, but it just came to me download, that I call this as the universal timeout. This was an opportunity for us, because last year when I did the consultation for the year, it said that prepare yourself spiritually, financially. And if you're an entrepreneur or if you are a healer or someone who's interested in empowering the world, do your work this year. So take the classes and do it. And it says that those who did their work will be the leaders, and those who did not do the work will be the followers of these leaders. So in saying that, I'm saying that it is very, very important for us, because it said 2020 was going to be a year that this is a time for empowerment, for global awareness. And when the reading first came out, it said that it's important for us to know that the one thing that we are connected to is the fact that we are the only original and consistent place that we always come back to is to a place of peace and love. And so throughout that consultation, it was saying that I don't focus so much on what's going to happen, but I like to give solutions. Because to say what's going to happen, only the universal source knows what's going to happen. But the Odu was speaking towards, this is a time for us. We prepared last year, so this is a year for us to do. And some of us that are entrepreneurs and health and wellness and coaches and business coaches that know that this is a time of abundance for many of us because we did our work. So this is a time unapologetically just saying, I'm so glad that I'm available to do God's work, whichever way it shows through me and for me and to me. So that's why I'm saying that today I want to really, this is a very serious time for us to, so I brought my papers today so I can stay focused. Because, you know, I'd be all over the place with excitement because I stay excited. And so I want to just say thank you for granting me this space to speak and give my perspective, my voice to those who perhaps feel voiceless or perhaps have saying the same thing. As a faith-based leader, I feel it's my responsibility and duty to let people know how I feel about the new change in the world. I have been experiencing many of the emotions that thousands of people around the world, I guess millions, are experiencing. Shock, rage, sorrow, confusion, and pain as we witness a human being pin another human being to the ground with his hands in his pockets. The one thing that gave me hope when I could feel hopeless in knowing that as an Ifa practitioner, Orisha practitioner, the Yoruba of Southwest Nigeria's spiritual system believe that when we leave the spiritual world to become a physical being as an expression of the divine, one of the three ways we come back knowing that we choose to come here to this present existence. And part of our destiny is given to us as a way to evolve and to bring love to the world. So when I recognized in the midst of all that I was feeling, when I saw one human being pin another human being for 9 minutes with his hands in his pocket like he was chilling, like it was okay with him, I said, who is this message going to? It was not going to the people because it's been such an ongoing practice of murdering Black people without accountability. So I would say, wait a minute, he's sending a message to his fellow police officers that you can do this and chill. He was chilling. That's what got to me more so. I didn't even look, I could not look at Mr. George Floyd. I could not look at him. I looked at the police and his face was like, hey, it's open season, my brothers. And that's what, and brothers and sisters, because there are female police officers as well. And so when we come back on earth, we choose to be here. And I said, wait a minute, I chose to be here? So this means there's something that I have to do and learn and be at this point in my life. So remembering that, what gave me the hope when I witnessed such a horror of this systematized racism that I've witnessed since coming to America in 1962. And so the looting, the rioting, the protesting, I believe is just the symptoms of what people feel they must do to be changed, for the change that everyone is seeking, and that is obviously that is time. If we don't know why we came on earth, then we can lose sight of the importance we have in making this world a better place. We are expressions of God and tools to share love and create a world where that we realize we have more in common than we have differences. Why? Because we are all stuck and we chose to come back on this planet. We didn't choose to come back to Mars, Jupiter. We did not come back to choose to come to Venus. And so for me, the protesters, the loafers and the rioters are emotionally expressing themselves. And so the protesters care about what's happening in the community and want to raise their voices and they want to raise their voices and be heard and to be seen. And they're like the fire that's starting to make the commitment to change our community and hold our elected officials accountable for how we want to change the current situation. That's for me, the protesters, they're coming from a place of completely, they want to raise their voices and they are strictly coming that they want what's happening. They care about what's happening. Mm-hmm. Now you have the rioters. Those that are rioting are those who, out of rage, they just take an opportunity to just destroy the community even their own homes because of the systematized racism. A lot of the homes are not owned by them. They're renters. And we'll talk about the systematized system that allows people to feel that the best thing and the only thing they can do is the things that we flaunt in front of them as this is success. They, well, I'm gonna get mine. And some people that those are the rioters. Now the looters, you know, so the rioters, because of the systematized racism of the economic pandemic, the sociological pandemic, and the lack of faith-based leaders, by a large majority, are not coming together in a bipartisan way to address America's crisis. This is not an a crisis on Black people. This is a world crisis, because Black people have been murdered in the street by police. And not only Black people, but people, there, the injustice, there's an imbalance where the police are supposed to protect us. And they are showing us that don't call me because you might be putting your life in danger. And so that's who you have, the rioters. Now the looters, these are just there to get things that are that a way of getting what some of us may find that, you know, you can't get this. So they're just like, I'm using this opportunity because of the American economic system that was built on free labor. And they're just, okay, I'm gonna get mine. So they're out there. So you have the protesters, you have the looters, and you have the rioters. The people who are rioting, they're just tearing up because they're angry and they says, I'm gonna get the attention. The looters, they're just taking it. And the thing of it is that in some cases, some of the looters are not of the African descended community. They found a police officer with a box of shoes putting it in his car. So looters are those who are feeling that because of the free labor system, Black people and everywhere are attempting to make of themselves available to what it is that is theirs. They make that it's time for me to get some of this. I'm not saying that is right, but this is what, these are the symptoms. And so there's such a gap between those who have and those who do not. So after the 400 years of building this economy base for the wealth of the world, why are Black people still unable to lessen the gap that is open? That is the what's happening here. And for me, many Americans have looked in the other direction instead of really addressing why this is happening. I hear people saying, oh, the rioting, this is horrible. How they destroying the whole community? Why they stealing stuff? Why can't they put themselves up by their own bootstrap? The economic system is not bent on you pulling up your system, because every time that the system is created, they change the rules. They change the rules. I usually don't get in touch with, stay in touch with politics, which I call politics, but I do vote. Because politics is when we don't know that the politics, we have the right under this flag to be the voice of putting people in our, and holding our officials accountable. And so for many of our Black and white friends, they are addressing, why is this happening? It is a national crisis that is going to require everything and everyone coming together. If we do not come together, because this is the change that is required at this time, at this moment, because failure to do that, it's going to be about the young people are fighting for change. I remember, and I'm jumping ahead of myself. The young people are fighting to change the world we have handed down to them. We have given this to these children. We told them there's justice in America. You can have a friend that is a different race, a different nationality. This is a great world. And then we're saying, there is a man holding his neck down, and we're supposed to say, oh, mom, what do you think about that? No, these children are like, no, we're going to change the world, because the world that you handed us to us is not fair. And y'all are too old. Because, you know, they think if you're 35, you're old. And if you're too old, we're going to be that difference. And so the change that is required is the turning point that is obvious now. The way we will change what is going on will come in a process. This process will be in the way we stand up for each other, support each other, and love each other will be heard in the way we want, the way what we hold our elected officials on both sides, the Black and white officials, and implement a restructuring of the laws. restructuring, because some of them are so, and some of them are just not even being respected, and change some of the attitudes. We cannot have lasting change if we just come up with a plan that doesn't resolve the cases of, and I want to just take this time here to pour water. And you know, I'm a priestess, so when I call the name of the ancestors, I have to pour. And I am pouring here in honor of Eric Garner. And these are people who were murdered by the hands of the police since 2019 to 2020. I pour libation here to Eric Garner, John Crawford III, Michael Brown, Ezell Ford, Dante Parker, Michelle Kusoff, Laquan McDonald, George Mann, Tanisha Anderson, Ake Gurley, Tamar Rice, Ibaya Turum, Romaine Bresbon, Jerame Reed, Matthew G. Ajibade, Frank Smart, Natasha McKenna, Tony Robinson, Anthony Hill, Maya Hall, Philip White, Eric Harris, Ibaya Turum, Walter Scott, William Chapman II, Alexia Christian, Brendan Glenn, Victor Manuel La Rosa, Jonathan Saunders, Freddie Blue, Joseph Mann, Salvador Ellswood, Sandra Bland, Ibaya Turum, Albert Joseph Davis, Barrios Stewart, Billy Ray Davis, Samuel Bibose, Michael Sabi, Brian Keith Day, Christian Taylor, Troy Robinson, Ashams Pharos Manley, Felix Kumi, Keith Harrison McLeod, Junior Prosper, Lamontes Jones, Patterson Brown, Dominic Hutchison, Anthony Ashford, Alonzo Smith, Ibaya Turum, Tyree Crawford, India Kager, Lavante Biggs, Michael Lee Martian, Lamar Clark, Richard Perkins, Nathaniel Harris Pickett, Bennett, Benny Lee Tignor, Miguel Espinal, Michael Noel, Kevin Matthews, Betty Jones, Quintonio LeGreer, Keith Childress Jr., Janet Wilson, Randy Nelson, Antron Scott, Wendell Celestine, David Joseph, Kaylin Rockemore, Deshaun Perkins, Christopher Davis, Marker Loud, Peter Gaines, Tori Robinson, Ibaya Turum, Darius Robinson, Kevin Hicks, Mary Trujillo, DeMarcus Seamer, Willie Tillman, Peril Thomas, Sylville Smith, Alton Sterling, Philando Castle, Ibaya Turum, Terrence Crutcher, Paul O'Neill, Alteria Woods, Jordan Edwards, Aaron Bailey, Ronell Foster, Stephen Clark, Antoine Rose II, Botham Jean, Pamela Turner, Dominique Clayton, Antashiana Jefferson, Christopher Whitfield, Christopher McCorney, Eric Rielson, Michael Lorenzo Dean, Brianna Taylor, and of course, George Floyd. These are not hashtags. These are not hashtags. These are people, human beings, that this society don't feel that it's important enough for us to change what is expected. The change has to come, and the change has to come now. But when we resolve to overlay, you know, to just look at the systemic problems that we have in our culture and focus on the police accountability and invoke the laws correctly. We have the laws. We have the laws. For someone to kneel in someone's neck and with his hands in his pocket, and you have to go and find out, is he guilty? If that was the other way around, he would have been shot on sight. He wouldn't have made it to the police department. And so we have to hold the police accountable. The looting and burning is just the symptoms of the problem. We have to come to deal with the cause of the problem. And the cure of the problem, in my opinion, is justice and social improvement programs. Because we are lining up the police with all of these weapons like they're going to fight enemies. They're fighting their children. They're fighting their own neighbors. I saw one policeman push a person at 72 years old out of the way, and they were standing. It made me remember when I saw in China, when the children were trying, the young people, it's always the youth. They are our vision. We created them to be here for us. I'll never forget that. When the police had tanks that they were driving over the people of China, and this one man, he said, enough is enough. Roll over me. Roll over me. That's what made me remember that. And that's when it stopped. It was enough was enough. And so the cure for me, in my opinion, is justice and social improvement as to why is it that we have this systemized system that allow one race, one group, one position to hold everyone else accountable. And so we just have to have overall change in all of the laws. And the old systems that have not been enforced, we need police change. We need to have real, everyone in position of leadership has to use their voices. We need people of power to remove their blindness. We have to have programs to educate people that when you see on television that all Black people are worthless or no good, like someone, they had a lawyer on the news today that she said something that she's going to support the present administration, unlike the monkey that we had before. We have people that still continue to feel that people of color don't have any value, don't have any worth. So we have to take off that blindness. We need to have our voices. We need our votes. We need to have our outrage. That's the only way we're going to do it, because if we don't do that, we're going to fall for the okey-doke. So in 1968, when I first witnessed a race riot in America, the thing that changed the outcome was the involvement on the national and international level of faith-based ministers. Today, I am not seeing the clergy of all denominations coming together, lending their voices, their bodies, and presence as a united front. That's what made the difference in 1968, is because we had faith-based leaders, arm in arm, holding hands, marching. We don't see that today. Where's the Pope? That's my question. Where is the Pope? How does he know that that young man that was on the ground was not one of his parishioners? And he's silent. That for me. And so it took me a lot to come to this today, because usually I'm just, you know, peace and love. But this is the only way we're going to get to love and to peace, is that we, as faith-based healers, And pastors, we need to hold ourselves accountable to coming out. These young people are out here hoping, and you know, we're doing what we can in terms of supporting them and holding them in our hearts and prayers, but we need to make our bodies physically seen, people of power. I don't see them coming together. And so everybody now is living in their own little group. I'm this, I'm that, and that's their fight. And this is what? That's what happened with Hitler. Some Jews, many Jews were saying, that's not going to happen. People in America, in Europe, this will never happen. We'll never have someone that just lead people into just murder. Oh, I mean, to just wipe them out. That'll never happen. When we did the same thing to the Japanese, oh, that'll never happen in America. And it happened. So this is an opportunity for us to understand that this is a world crisis. It's an American crisis. What happens because of this depends on all of us working together. We no longer live isolated or in a vacuum. Due to social media and cameras, we are closer together than we've ever been before. So it's time to unite, fight for the liberation of our minds, bodies, and spirits, because this is the only planet we have to live on. The future is up to us and how we continue to do so. So that's what it is that I find as a faith-based healer. I want to know if there are other Ifa Orisha practitioners who are ready to join together to do the work. All of us cannot protest physically, but we know that the vast knowledge to bring unity and strength and safety in our community, many of us have done this and continue to do rituals and ceremonies, perform community ceremonies and rituals to keep us healed and safe in our temples. Ifa, in its vast knowledge-based power, has the solution. The solution, in my opinion, is coming together in spite of differences, past hurts, pain, lack of community, lack of communication, or sometimes just lack of knowledge. Forgiveness of each side. Some say I'm Lukumi, some say I'm Ifa, I'm Asheche, whatever. We have to come together because we have a common enemy. The common enemy is injustice. And so to move forward to change, the policies that will take us to the next level is knowing that we came here for a reason. We chose to be here. You know, and so there are a couple of YouTube things that I think that will, in my opinion, can help shed light on some of the questions, the issues, and attitudes that have been brought America to this point. One of them is a very good presentation. You can see it on YouTube. It's called White Fragility by Dr. Robin DiAngelo. And it's a white woman that writes it, and it just takes the glasses off of everything. And the name of it is Why It's So Hard for White People to Talk About Racism. It's called White Fragility by Dr. Robin DiAngelo. Why It's So Hard for White People to Talk About Racism. And the next thing that I would like and encourage all of us to watch is the YouTube that's called 13, a full feature combining archive footage of what is happening in our prison system. So that is what I wanted to share today. Y'all know that I'm very passionate. I had to call each of these ancestors up because it's time for us to gather. It is time for us to unite. It is time for us to hold the police accountable. And all of us that know how to do ceremonies and rituals, we've done it before. That's what freed Haiti is, because we did rituals. We're here in spite of any differences that we had in the past, and that let me know that I'm available to do. And I do have some rituals that I have done in claiming our community as ours. So that's what I wanted to say. So thank you for the past 20 minutes of just sharing what's been on my heart, and just thanking God that I chose to come here. And so it's my responsibility to do something about it. So Akanke, please, can you say something that can, you know, shed light to what it is that we've been talking about as mother and daughter?
Yeah, so thank you, Yeye, for all that you just shared. I was here taking some notes down. And I want to thank everybody who's been commenting here. I see Het Haru here, Geraldine, Yanifa, Victoria, Krista, they're all commenting here. So thank you for joining the conversation. And so here's what's going on with me and the reason why I wanted to join my mom today as she spoke with you, because I recently watched that documentary that she just mentioned, the 13th. And watching it allowed me to realize that I've been asleep. As a Black person in this country, there are many areas in which I have been asleep. And obviously, being a part of the Black community, there are things I'm aware of, but then there are some things that I just wasn't aware of. And so this documentary inspired me. It upset me. It had me feel very frustrated. There were even points in there where I felt a little hopeless. But by the time it ended, I said, okay, I have to do something more as a Black person in this country, as a Black person in the world, I have to take a greater responsibility for helping to change the status quo. So I knew that it had to be something measurable, something that at the end of the day, at the end of the week, at the end of the year, I can look back and said, I did this to create change, instead of just talking, instead of just complaining about what's going on, or instead of just talking about what we need to do and the fact that things need to change, but actually taking measurable action is what came up for me. And so for me, what came to mind is, as Black people in this country, or at least for me, I feel like there are three areas of power that I have. And those three areas are the power of my mind, the power of my vote, and the power in my dollar. And so I said, okay, so in these three areas, I can make a difference. And then I'm thinking about all Black people, because after a while I'm watching this documentary, they're talking about all these laws that were created to oppress Black people and brown people. And so for me, I'm looking at this and say, okay, so my vote, I need to make sure I'm always voting. I have voted ever since I was 18. Even when I am not 100% behind the candidate, I still vote because of all the people who died so that I could vote. And so I know that there is power in my vote. So of course I continue to do that. And of course the power of my mind and what I'm going to focus on and what's my attitude going to be about a given situation, and understanding that what I'm feeding into my mind will ultimately create my reality. So those two areas. And then the final answer, I said, this is where I can put a measurable difference, an additional measurable difference. And that is with where it is that I am spending my money. You know, in that documentary, The 13th, they pointed out all of these different companies that support the politicians who are creating these laws to keep Black and brown people oppressed and in prison. And so I'm looking at these companies and I'm thinking, oh my goodness, I have shopped at these places. And so so what this is for me is that my commitment, and I invite you to commit to this as well, is to start paying close attention to where you are spending your money, to who it is that you're giving your money to. I mean, I'm talking as looking at the groceries that you purchase, the brands that you love, you know, and you know, maybe it's Nabisco, maybe it's, you know, the Clorox company or something like that, but paying attention to the companies that you are purchasing their products and what politicians, what organizations are these companies giving money to? So my commitment is to be hyper aware of what it is that I am purchasing. You know, in the documentary, I was blown away by the company, the product I use, that they're responsible for the police officers, you know, running around like they're in combat gear, like they're going to war in our community. I have purchased products by the companies that have funded that. And I imagine there are a lot of people, there are a lot of African Americans out there, we're putting our money down and we're not paying attention to where that money is going. So I'm calling myself out for being ignorant, for being asleep with regard to that. And I'm calling you out, sisters and brothers and our white allies, to really start looking at where it is that you are spending your money. The clothes that you are buying, those companies that create the clothes, you know, what politicians, what organizations are they funding? You know, all of these politicians have to disclose where their funding comes from so we can find that out. The other thing, you know, that your household items, like I said, your groceries, find out about the company and who they are supporting. So this being said, you know, Black Lives Matters is all over the place. And so I said, you know, what kind of movement can I help to support or help to like stir up? And in my conversation with my mom, you know, we're talking about how it is that we can make a measurable difference starting today. And so just out of the universe, the words came to me for this movement. And, you know, and I'm sure I'm not the first one to talk about this particular subject around being conscious consumers. But what came to me is this: Black dollars matter. Black dollars matter. So I said, oh, we got to create something here. We have to create this whole movement so that African Americans and Black people all over the world can start being more conscious and aware of what we are supporting. Every single dollar we spend, we are supporting something. We are supporting some organization. And so Black Dollars Matter is really going to be about exposing the companies and exposing the products that we use and ultimately where that money is going. Because like I said, three areas of power that I have and three areas of power that every Black person in this country has and brown person in this country has is, citizens in a way, is the power of our mind, the power of our vote, and the power of our dollar. And I believe that in order to create real change in the world, what's really going to matter here is our dollar, because we live in a democracy. We live in a country that's all about money. Money is power in this country. And so my thing is, let's hit them where it really hurts, in the pocketbook. Let's hit them where there's really going to make a big difference. So my invitation to you, brothers and sisters, is to get behind this movement that I am calling Black Dollars Matter. And I'm calling out Black people. I'm calling out brown people. I'm calling out all people of color and all of our white allies to get behind this. I'm going to create an Instagram page so that we can post organizations there. We can post information that we have found out. And if you know of any websites, you have any resources that can support this movement, if you have a link that says, hey, here's a place where these are lots of companies and they've given to the Republican Party, or they've given to, you know, this company, this organization called ALEC, A-L-E-C, which watched that 13th documentary, and you are going to find out about this organization. So send me those links. Let's post those links on either here on Yeye's page, or we can post them, you know, send me a DM. I'm Akanke Adefumi on Facebook. I'm not only Akanke Adefumi on Facebook. So if you have some links, you have some resources, send them to me, y'all. Send them to me, y'all. And let's create a movement. And I'm going to the grocery store, you know, in the next couple of days. And I am, before I go there, I want to look up some products that are like my go-to products. I want to find out, you know, who is responsible for creating them and who is it that they're supporting, and beyond that and beyond that. And so hashtag Black Dollars Matter. Let's do it, because that is, in this country, money is power. So let's take back our power. Let's be conscious about who we're giving our money to. Let's take back our power, and then things will begin to start changing. We don't have to go out there looting and all of that, but what we can do is start looking at who we're saying, here, you can have my money to support this organization. You can have my money to support this law. You can have my money. Let's start paying attention to what's really going on. All right, sister? All right. Thank you, Victoria, for putting hashtag Black Dollars Matter. Yes. Lakeisha is saying, follow the dollar. The more we know helps us to take back our power. Yes. Sakina is saying she totally agrees. Lakeisha is truth. Make it easier to be informed. Yeah. That's what I have to say today.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. That was right on time. There are so many products and that are created by Black people that we don't even know. They are, I mean, there's one group that I used to get, and now I'm going back to them, is getting my soap powder. It's a group in these young people in Atlanta. Their soap powder is just amazing. I'm going back to get it from them now that you inspire me, and I even remember. But there's so many companies. Black women and Black men have their companies. I just read that there's a new company started where they are the now Hub Grub is Black owned. There are many African American money in it. We are the most educated people on the planet, or the African descended people in America. We have an economy. I don't have the stats with me, but we are billions and billions of consumers. So let's start putting those dollars into our community. Next question, why am I banking in a bank that when I go to get some money, I have to jump through them? Why don't I go to the little, what do you call it in Oakland? There's a the alternative to a bank. My mind, it just went zoop over my head. So someone put it in the hashtag, if you know what I'm talking about. So we can take our banks out of there and put them into our credit unions. Credit unions existed for us when the banks wouldn't even take our money. We have to remember that this is America, and I spoke to before on that this is a place that we're supposed to be the example of democracy. We're supposed to be the ones that create the status quo for every other nation. You know, when we were when we wanted to ride in the front of the buses because we were paying the same fees, and the white people said, no, you can't do that. We said, oh, okay. So we won't take the bus. We didn't take the bus for 3 months. That brought a whole lot of change. Those little 25 cents that those people were putting in there, and the workers went to work. They got into trucks, buggies, horses, whichever way they went to work. They found a way, but it brought America to recognize, wait a minute, this is stupid because of the color of their skin, they got to sit in the back of the bus. So it didn't come because we were marching in that. We just said, okay, let's take back our dollar. I remember I was in Senegal. It was in the 80s, and they had been raising the price of flour for the market women every day, every month. It was another raise. And we were like, we cannot live. We are the bread makers. And we can't continue with this. I think it was Senegal or Sierra Leone, whichever country that I was in, West Africa. Don't quote me on the location, but the facts. And so the women kept saying, wait a minute, y'all are raising the cost of flour. We're not going to be able to live. We're not going to, that's what we do. We make bread. You know what they did? They stopped. They said, okay, we won't make any bread. Brought it to a halt. Just by stop buying flour. They said, that's okay. We can get plantains and we can mash those and we can make bread like we used to do. Brought the country to a halt, and then they had to say, okay, from this point on, the women are in control and setting the price of we have to. Yeah. So there are many organizations, many business owners that are doing phenomenal jobs at putting out new products. So everybody put that in the link.
Yeah.
My daughter, and if you know Akanke, she is a follow-through person. She will hold us accountable. She will follow through. So do your math in finding out what companies, but also do our research as to buying Black products. Support our Black sisters and brothers in all of the products that we are. We are genius.
Yeah.
We're genius. And I know, in closing, what I wanted to say here is that I know that as a faith-based leader, we have to question ourselves, what are we telling our parishioners? What are we telling our temple? But in 1954, Congress approved an amendment to prohibit 501c3 organizations, which include charities, churches, from engaging in any political campaign or activity. This ban was strengthened in 1987, and currently the law prohibits political campaigns, activity by churches and clergy. They cannot publish, distribute, or intervene in any kind of political campaign opposition of any candidate. Perhaps that's why I haven't heard the Pope and the mega churches and the leaders of powerful faith-based organization come out in strength than they did in 1968. So perhaps that's what it is, that they cannot come and make a statement. But you know, we can find ways of coming together, and you can make a statement, you can gather money, you can send it to your cousin and let that money get into the Black community. Fatal force. People who were shot and killed by the police in 2019. Look at this. This is just people.
Yeah.
It's just shot and without any kind of accountability. So if we are going to change that, and in 2018 was 991 people. So when we call on these people, we have to do something. We cannot feel hopeless. We cannot depend on anyone else. We have to increase, you know, Black Lives Matter started in 2014 by the killing of Michael Brown in Ferguson. And so as an increase, their focus was on police accountability. Police accountability, spending dollars in programs that's going to find the community, the foundation. What is the reason that we systematize racism? That's what we need to put the funding in, rather than giving these policemen gear that they're going to shoot their own children, their own school teachers that they had maybe 4 or 5 years ago. So for me, my question and my to you, I ask you, faith-based leaders, this is your time to do something in your temple. This is your time to be vocal. This is your time to come out here, because these are your parishioners that's out there losing their life. That man that was pushed down to the ground, there's a woman, she was 75 years old. She was pushed to the ground, and I saw she was standing there with a sign and says, peace. And a policeman pushed her, and another one went to hold her, and his friend policeman pulled him off, and they walked away and left her. To me, we need to continue being outraged to do something. Everybody has a place to do. Remember, you chose to be here based on your understanding. You chose to be here at this time. You are the change that you asked for and that you want to see. Don't give our children a legacy of us being impotent and for us to just stand by and say that maybe it'll change in the next generation. It has to change now. So any closing words you have to say other than your hashtag Black Dollars Matter? I love that.
Yeah. So follow me, because you're going to hear more about the Black Dollars Matter movement. So follow me on Facebook, connect with me, and I will definitely connect with you. And you'll hear more about this. My ask is that you help me to put the information out there. You know, sometimes we wait for other people to do things for us instead of actually doing it for ourselves. And so my ask is that you participate in helping to build this database, in a way, this database where people can come and find information. And instead of waiting for somebody else to do it, instead of waiting for me to do it, go out there, find out information. I'm happy to be this place where I'm helping to sort of promote the information or expand the reach of the information. I'm happy to do that, but I need support. I need help. Getting this information, cultivating, curating the information. So if you know resources, like I asked earlier, send them to me, DM me, send me a direct message with links and all of that, and I'm happy to. So that's really my parting words. And you know, again, our three main powers in this country is the power of your mind, the power of your vote, and the power of your dollar. So, you know, there are I've been seeing a lot of, you know, Black people, we've been doing work to end racism for years. And I'm just so excited to see so many of our white allies now taking ownership of their participation in the status quo. And, you know, they're putting out there things that are helping to make a difference in the world. I also want to just further say that as Black people, we also have to, you know, we've been doing work, but now it's time for us to up our game in another way. It's time for us to up our game in another way. And we live in a capitalistic society. So let's start using that power. Let's start using it, because I believe that once we start really being conscious consumers, then that is going to help to have to create even a bigger wave of change in this country and in the world. So so thank you, Yaya, for having me as your guest. And I look forward to us having further conversations about this topic.
I share. Well, after you close out, you know me, I'm gonna close out again. It's a close out.
Okay, you got like 3 minutes to close out.
So the close out is, we have to hold our white friends accountable. We have to educate them. A lot of white people do not understand. And that's why the book, White Fragility by Dr. Robin DiAngelo, why it's so hard for white people to talk about racism. Watch that. And talk to our friends, hold them accountable. It's all right to say I have Black friends, but my question is, when there's no one else represented that looks like a Black person in a meeting that you're having, then you should be that one white person that says, how come we don't have a white Black person? And I think you be that voice, be bold, white friends, because I have white friends. So I'm holding my white friends accountable now, not to say that I have Black friends, but be the voice. I share it. That's my closing words. I do pray, Orisha. I do. Mother, Father, God, we give thanks for all the spirits of everyone that we call today and everyone that's listening to us. And please share this, make it viral, take it on. Ashe, ashe, modupwe, obatala, asheo. Everybody have a wonderful day. Be the change you want to be. Get your dollars.